Andre mentioned a tunable called VM Swappiness. Let me pull up my machine here. These are all the different virtual memory tunables that you have for the kernel. And Andre was talking about this one, Swappiness. And so if we just take a look at it, the default for this machine is a Swappiness value of 30. This is a value that runs between 0 and 200. Many of you are probably going, wait, I thought it was between 0 and 100.
Right.
200. This is a more recent change to how the kernel manages swap space. And so essentially, what you're setting with Swappiness is, one, how aggressively the kernel should use swap, and two, what type of thing it should target for swapping. So basically between 1 and 100, you're telling the kernel that you would prefer it to swap page cache, which is cached memory that we use for various other things. Between 101 and 200, you're telling the kernel you would prefer it to be more aggressive swapping anonymous pages. Both anonymous pages and page cache are candidates for swapping, and the swap setting tells the kernel which one of those two you're more interested in having it swap when managing the swap space. At a swap space of 30, or a swappiness of 30, I'm telling it I am more interested in it using for doing swapping, and I'm also not super aggressive when trying to swap page cache. And I should not really be super aggressive about swapping anonymous pages.
Okay, so a number over 100 would mean that your priority, your preference, is toward the anonymous. The higher the number, then what, the more aggressive? Or the lower the number, the more aggressive? Is 100 the middle point, and like this way is more aggressive one way and this way is more aggressive the other way? Or is it more like...
So essentially like 100, let's just call it 100. You're saying, I want you to be more aggressively swappy, and I want you to be aggressively swappy around around page cache. And at 101, we start to tip the other way. And it's like, I want you to be aggressively swappy, but I want you to be aggressively swappy on page cache and a little bit on anonymous pages.
Okay. And the closer to 200 you get, the more you lean toward anonymous.
Correct. So like
at and the closer to zero you get, the more aggressive you get toward virtual memory.
The closer to zero you're getting, you're telling it that you want it to be, you want it to be less aggressive when swapping things.
Less aggressive towards, okay.
Yeah.
All right. Sorry if I'm confusing people. I'm trying to make sure that not only that I better understand it, but that the people viewing get a better understanding of it.
There's actually a really great article on this written by Chris Down, who works at Meta as a SRE, but he does a lot of kernel stuff. So give me 1 second and I will paste it into our thing here. And it, he actually gives a kind of formula for when I set it at this versus that, how do I actually address that for swap space, right? So if encryption is not hitting home, there is a formula where you can plug in the numbers and it'll like tell you which one you're being more and less aggressive on.
There was a question about when this was introduced in the kernel. I don't know that we have that information offhand, or even if the article goes into that. Like when the over 100 was introduced in the kernel, or has it always been there?
I did not see it until RHEL 8-ish. I don't know exactly when it came in. I changed the swappiness, and because I set it to over 100, now I'm preferring anonymous pages to page cache when performing swapping. But I'm not super aggressive, right? If it was more like 200, now I'm going to be super aggressive. And so the differential between them is how do we use page cache versus anonymous pages? Why would I manipulate this way? You'll notice that if you look at online guides, almost all of them have you setting swappiness to a value less than 100, and many of them, including things like database workloads and other stuff, have you setting it down to like 10 or 20 as your preferred size. Some will even go further and say you should set it to 1 because they want it to be as least swappy as possible. But what you're really doing is telling it you want it to be as least swappy as possible on anonymous pages, because it turns out that all those workloads allocate memory and use that memory inside their process space to do things like their own internal caching. And so by swapping out anonymous pages from applications, you're swapping out application-specific data that if the application needs it, now it has to swap back in again, which is a slow process, right? It can hamper your performance of your application. And so when the database and other application vendors are saying, set it really low to like 1, what they're doing is saying, if you're going to swap page cache, because we want to keep our anonymous pages in memory so that if we need them, it doesn't cause our application to be slow because we have to wait for a swap-in process. So that's what is happening with swapping.
Will, yeah. William and Chad brings up a good point. There's a tool in RHEL, and I guess any distribution that supports TooniD, that will allow you to use TooniD profiles to set swappiness. You may not have to care about it if it's a TooniD profile fits your needs. So if you don't want to have to think about it, you could look into TooniD profiles.
Billy is like, again, our audience is great today. They're like forward-looking. So our wait at the end of the episode is going to be like, try TooniD, because I just set the swappiness value in memory, which means if I reboot the machine, it'll go back to its default, which was 30. So how do you persist changes? And you can use syscontrol, but a more modern way would be to use TooniD. I'm going to throw people a TooniD lab that I think will give them a good introduction and primer to setting permanent tunable changes using the TooniD daemon, which is turned on by default in RHEL. I wanted to cover a couple other virtual memory tunables. I wanted to talk about trap caches. So in the critical path, Nate showed us free, right? And part of free is this memory that we're using for buffers and caches. Drop caches will purge this memory or whatever is not actively being used in this memory. And so you can send different values into drop caches to drop different types of caches. If I send a 1 into drop caches, it drops slab cache, a pre-allocated pile of memory that's a specific size the kernel can just like hand to applications that are asking for memory. So echoing 1 into drop caches will drop the slab cache, which is included in this buffers and cache line. Echoing a 2 into this is going to drop slab cache and page cache. So you start to drop maybe things that we've looked up on disk that we're storing in memory so we don't have to go out and look it up on disk again, or memory that was decommitted, but we haven't yet cleaned it to reuse that memory registered. So it's sticking around in page cache. And then 3, if you echo 3 into drop caches, you could see that it significantly lowered my cache memory. That says drop all caches except for dirty pages. So these are like buffered disk IO writes that haven't been flushed to disk yet. Those will persist, and that's why it didn't go to 0. It also won't flush active buffer network connections because they're active and they're used. And if we drop them, that would be bad. It drops your directory entry page and slab cache if you echo 3 into that. Do you want to do this? Probably not. We kept that stuff in cache for a reason. It typically will make the system operate smoother. Periodically, the kernel, if you're in a low free memory situation where you need some additional memory or you're using a lot of your memory and there's not a lot of free memory, the kernel will automatically reduce the amount used for caching to bump up the amount that is freely available. If there is a large memory request that comes in from an application, the kernel will drop some cache memory in order to free up memory to handle this large memory request that came in. And that's why in the current version of free, under free memory, you actually get all of the available for use memory. Whereas in old versions of free, it would not include buffers and caches, because right. That was being else, right? So it wasn't free. But the reality is we can allocate it back from buffers and caches easily, and now it can be used as free memory. So in the latest versions of free, the free memory includes that memory over there in buffers and caches. And that's actually, you'll see if you look at free and available, the numbers are close, except for those buffers and caches I wasn't able to get rid of when I dropped them.